Marc used to say success is like riding on the back of a Tyrannosaurus Rex, but it may turn round and bite your head off.
He created glam rock, but unfortunately, of course, then everybody jumped on the bandwagon and you know, sort of like people like sort of Gary Glitter pushed it to silly extremes.
People called him a glam rock star, and he was really, but he and Gary Glitter and Elton John and Slade, all part of that so-called glam rock thing. But I think Marc was a little bit above that, actually. He was much cooler than that. I think he was a bit hipper.
There was more to T-Rex, and they did suffer when it all sort of beginning to move again. Their popularity sort of stopped and waned a bit, but I always thought they were just a fantastic band, and Marc was a great writer of a boogie and a riff.
He was starting to lose a little bit of that oomph that he'd had in the past, and I think the fans were starting to move away.
T-Rex started to sort of lose a little bit of impetus, and he started to reassess himself.
Cool, very good. Whatever happened to the Teenage Dream? Such a good record, you know, and such a brave record, because it had gone a little bit wobbly.
Obviously an autobiographical song, and rather strangely, I remember that there were three songs out at the same time, all with Teenage in the title. Alice Cooper's Teenage Lament, Marc's Teenage Dream, and The Suite with Teenage Rampage. And, you know, sort of, obviously at the time I would never have admitted that in actuality, if I'm really honest, of the three songs, the best of the three is actually The Suite's Teenage Rampage. Probably, I think, because of the fact that's what teenagers want to do, really, isn't it? They want to rampage.
This was him, again, just, you know, just tickling the chin of the undercurrent of the mothers and fathers and the adults, and just having a bit of fun on there. And I think, you know, it has a really oldie world feel to me as well. You know, it has a lot of stuff going on in there. Lyrically, like I say, it's not explicit or anything like that, but it's you know, it's verging on that sort of that fun side, a little bit of the risky and stuff like that. Just a good fun piece, I think. But I was lost when her mouth turned green.
Was this kind of strange British take on rock and roll. If you weren't in on the joke that it was kind of spoofing early British rock and roll, like Cliff Richard and the Burt Weedens and the Billy Furies and that kind of, if you didn't quite get that joke, then I don't think it meant an awful lot.
I think Marc was definitely by that time, you know, he was starting to wonder, you know, whatever happened to the Teenage Dream, because he was the Teenage Dream and he was no longer getting to number one. And I don't think he knew why, you know, I don't think he'd worked out how to reverse that.
It just started to become a little bit of a mush to me then. It's just like they're not like, you know, Telegram Sam, and they're not like Metal Guru, they're not like Children of the Revolution, they're not like Ride Away Swan. Those classics, I just feel struggling. I always, you know, you like them, but sometimes you need more time to like them than you would the others. So maybe that's a good thing, maybe that's a bad thing.
Baby blue. he declared glam rock dead in 1974. He was looking for a new musical direction, but he never found a musical direction that was sort of commercial, that people actually wanted to buy, because he got into sort of like soul music.
Change is coming just like the sun. Change is coming, you better run.
If you look back on it, you can see that he is sort of coming to the end of writing all those singles, banging them out. And I think probably he wanted to get back into writing full album, proper album, not proper, because that's demeaning what he does, but more album-orientated stuff, and trying to build up a proper, more album-based following.
I was working with an American band called Carmen, based in London for a while, and managed to get as producer for our band a guy called Tony Visconti, who was working at the time with David Bowie, Marc Bolan, Paul McCartney. And at that time, Marc was restructuring the band. I think Bill Legend, bless him, had decided for whatever reason to retire for a short while or move on. And Tony was saying that, you know, could I go do some session work with Marc? And was taken down to Scorpio Studios, and we started recording Zinc Alloy and the Hidden Riders of Tomorrow album.
He's gonna be dead. Will you take the hand off the dick with mine? Oh yeah. Heater, we're a heater. He's such a messy eater. He got frogs in his eyes from telling those lies. Saturday's almost Monday, and you gotta understand he's gone.
It's a jumbled up cornucopia of all different influences and ideas, new and old, melding and clashing and exploding and hopefully turning us on.
As an artist, he was being given, put other colours onto his palette that maybe he couldn't use in his paintings quite so easily as other people.
Other things at this point could have been maybe becoming to influence slightly on his his creative side.
Marc was sort of always believed in himself. You know, from his earliest sort of days, he knew he was going to be a star. He wanted to be a star. That was his driving force. And of course, obviously, to believe in yourself that much means that you've got, you know, quite a big ego. And unfortunately, if you've got quite a big ego, then cocaine just makes it worse. It just makes it bigger. And then, of course, you know, at the same time, I think Marc was becoming surrounded by yes men who wouldn't tell him, you know, don't do that, it's rubbish.
His partnership with Tony Visconti had separated. Tony and Marc had kind of their friendship had gone thin halfway through the album of Zinc Alloy. So Marc had that to finish himself, and he thought that he was able to produce himself. So then he's writing without the influence of the guy that had helped him along so long, which was Tony Visconti. The plot was, you know, was a bit fuzzy.
It was a bad move to relocate to America, simply for the fact that he was now in the culture, in Hollywood, in that whole, you know, drugs, drink thing.
There was a period when I guess he was doing cocaine and drinking brandy, which he shouldn't have done because that made him put on weight, and that altered his personality slightly. He did become a little bit unbearable for a short period. It's to be expected, really. All rock stars go through their unbearable phase.
Another thing which I think did have a negative effect on his life was the splitting up of him with his wife June. And June was kept Marc sort of on quite a tight leash, really. And that was the thing, you know, Marc and June split up, and he was then a lot more free to eat what he wanted, to take, you know, sort of more drugs than June would probably have let him take, and to drink more.
Truck off tour I did with him, which was most of the tracks from the Zinc Ally album, when he was actually playing and doing his wild guitar work. Maybe some of the notes were right, maybe some of them weren't, but it didn't really matter. It's like looking at Salvador Dali. Was that correct, that what he painted? It didn't really matter, because that what he was doing as a musician, whether he played the right or wrong notes, it was the excitement, it was the way that he put it across that was exciting. I don't think that was a weakness.
Live, no, he always gave his all, Marc. He was always bouncing around, full of energy. But the only weak point, I would say, was that the numbers weren't terribly well rehearsed, you know. They'd fall apart maybe at the end. They didn't really think about endings. It was all sustained by the hysteria of the audience, the jamming. It's like a jamming band, really. And if you took away that kind of support, then it could collapse. It could, you know, they didn't really have the reserves of arrangements and songs to sustain like a whole 2-hour concert.
When he was sober, when he was playing, he was very, very powerful, very, very positive, and knew exactly what he wanted from himself and from other people.
Marc was in his element on stage, you know, because he was coquettish, he teased, he wound him up, he did it with a smile, he did it with his guitar, he did it with his trousers, he did it with his audience.
He did get quite good on the electric guitar. He was getting, he really took off on it, and he could make all the right moves, certainly, and make an exciting rock and roll noise on the lead guitar.
When I was recording at that time with Marc, he would have a song idea and so on, and he would sometimes give us a guide vocal, but then it could possibly change. When he went to the studio, he'd probably have half a dozen ideas and a few lyrics written down, but yet the song vocally wouldn't possibly, wasn't always complete. There was like, he'd say, no, it's going to go like, it's going to go like that. He knew basically the arrangement of the songs, but then it could change at any time.
Marc was a sponge. He sort of collected ideas and then sort of evolved them into his own thing. So I think it was a great loss for Marc when Mickey Finn left, or, well, really was sacked.
I would say that I don't think Marc noticed he was gone, because at that particular point he was developing other projects, and he was too involved in himself and his desperate need to succeed. So I don't think it was of a great impact to him. I think he just thought, well, that's how that is, that's okay, I'll just keep going.
Actually, that's a bloody good record. it's sort of overlooked a little bit, you know, it wasn't quite as successful. And it sort of shows you sort of where it's beginning to all beginning to sort of not fall, I hate that word fall apart, it's just beginning to lose its impetus. It's the actual audience and the band are beginning to struggle with the movement of it all, and it's just having, it's sort of treading water badly now.
These records were far superior work to a lot of what other people were doing, you know. But every painting Picasso did was not the Mona Lisa. In fact, none of them were.
By this time, I was sort of the only Marc Bolan fan that, well, at my school, in my class, everybody else had gone on to other things. And I also, this was the time actually that, of course, the press were, you know, were ridiculing Marc. He was putting on weight. They were starting to sort of call him the, you know, the pork chipolata and all sorts of, you know, sarcastic names. And I think that's actually when sort of people who declared themselves to be Marc Bolan fans did start to have the mickey taken out of them at school. And so I don't think Light of Love was one of his better singles.
Light of Love was probably one of the biggest disappointments for that era for T-Rex, because it didn't get to the positions that some of the earlier material had got to. And really, you know, Marc Bolan was starting to panic a bit here. And later on, the Light of Love album was actually released in America. This was again Marc Bolan having yet another attempt at trying to crack this American market, because he was so desperate to do it. And it was actually released as an album, Light of Love, and it just flopped.
Well, the American company said, okay, to break America you need these songs, so they put an album together to just specially for America.
And the American thing was planned badly. In retrospect, it was planned badly. Marc tried to go in too high, you know. But it's a very difficult situation, you know, when you're mega somewhere to come somewhere else and no one really cares that much.
The one thing about all great bands who make it in the United States, especially British bands, is you tour America, you meet fantastic musicians, you meet where rock and roll came from, you suck it all in, and I think you're a better musician for it. And I think just touring Europe and just going to Japan, where it was massive, and places like that, and going to America now and then, but not obviously digging in, it sort of restricted his creative sources. And I think it shows, one, that he's sort of a little bit bored, and I think that it shows that he's not gotten, there's not enough going into him. He's not sucking in enough of the influences.
I think if Marc would have pursued and worked and toured and stayed with America, they would have liked and loved him and would have had more patience, and he would then eventually have done it. But I know he did have a struggle with the American audiences.
I actually saw Marc in the States by chance. I was on tour with Humble Pie and they were playing a gig out in Long Island, I think. And I didn't know Marc was there. And when I got there, we found T-Rex playing away to a sort of a room full of rather drunken, inebriated students from New York. They weren't getting it on at all. They really couldn't get the T-Rex phenomenon. To be honest, he was dying to death. I felt, oh yeah, this is embarrassing. And we met on the plane coming back from New York back to London. And neither of us mentioned this terrible gig, and I didn't write about it, and Marc didn't mention it once on the whole journey back. So it's like sort of something you drew a veil over this.
And then of course we have DB, David Bowie, sussing this because he's a hip gentleman then and now. And sort of sliding in, and becoming Ziggy. But without Marc, there could not have been a Ziggy.
He took the glammy rocky thing, even though I don't think Bowie was that glammy rock anyway. He took the glam rock thing and the dressing up thing from Boland, and of course Bowie cracked it in America. And unfortunately, Matt Boland didn't do it. You know, T-Rex didn't really take off in the States. It was more a British thing. I think Americans could see it.
There was the friendship and the association with Bowie and Marc Bolan, but I think Marc always sort of quite resented the fact that David Bowie was having success in America, and he wasn't, but he was trying so hard.
The great thing about David Bowie was that he was, I think, maybe a little bit more in tune or more able to make a change and create new characters, because he was an actor, was able to act, so he could assume characters. And I think because he was probably looking and traveling around and watching what other bands were doing at the time, was able to create all these characters. He could tap into all those energies and use them. I think maybe Marc would probably have had to spend a little bit more time or spend a little bit more time in America.
They both grew up in London. I think Marc was very much more of a London boy than David was. He managed to sort of be a lot more sort of international. And so I think that was, Marc was basically, I think, a little bit too British to translate to American audiences.
If you've known somebody when they were broke and charming and friendly and happy, it's always a shock when you meet them, say 2 years after they've had their massive success, and they put on weight and they become jowly and grumpy and sort of see the world as their enemy. I'm not saying that happened to Marc in its entirety, but that does happen to rock stars. So he went through a little period of being a little bit over the top.
This was Marc, loosely speaking, in his Fat Elvis period. A thing that befalls many. John Lennon had his Fat Elvis period, you know. Sitting around looking at the swimming pool for inspiration. And Marc had his Fat Elvis period. And sometimes the music became Fat Elvis period.
Every time I was with Marc, it was like a party situation, very, very relaxing. You went into the studio, there was like food there, and there was wine and champagne, pink champagne he used to like to drink, and everybody was kind of very relaxed, and we're going to do this. No one was allowed to drink too much, but it was almost a party atmosphere, and never too much pressure, and that's what I remember about the time I was recording with Marc.
Zip Gun Boogie was a kind of a, it's probably something that he'd read in a New York juvenile delinquent book, which was all about zip guns from the 1950s and 60s. Because I remember reading a book about New York gangs using these zip guns, and I think that's probably where Marc got the idea from.
The single Zip Gun Boogie, I actually sort of, even though it didn't do as well as Light of Love, I personally preferred. I thought it had a more punchy beat. I thought Light of Love, Marc's vocals were kind of a little whiny.
Zip Gun, to me, not an album. It's stuff that's been recorded before, it's been around a long time. They obviously needed to deliver an album.
The Zipgun album, I think, the effect on sales of that was because Light of Love, which had been put out before in the States, had material that ended up on Zipgun.
It was a bit of a bizarre one for Bolan because he was pulling together all these things that had already been worked on and some of which had been available previously on American import. And it was actually the first album, the first T-Rex album, that Bolan had exclusively produced. He had fallen out with Tony Visconti. He had really fallen out with Mickey Finn, although Mickey is credited on that album. Obviously, he'd worked on some of the tracks when he was still in T-Rex. So 1975 for Marc Bolan was a really, really bad time. And it was almost like the low point of his musical career. And suddenly seeing that this album wasn't doing very well in England, which had always been his stronghold, and that it hadn't done well when it was originally released in America, I think Marc was really starting to question what it was that he was actually doing. Where was he going wrong? What did he need to do?
That record was part of the ladder to come in back again, you know? Marc had to get a whole bunch of stuff out of his system, I guess, you know? Make it big, lots of people wailing away, you know. 4 million guitars, da da da. You don't need it, you know.
Most fans sort of tend to think of it as being probably his worst album. Because let's face it, everybody's got to have one that's worst.
The New York City single was quite a point because he'd been sort of out of action as far as the hit singles and stuff go and floundering slightly somewhat, you know, desperately looking. And here's another case in point where it's one of those things that he actually did take himself away and look to create something. He was being influenced by probably the music of the day. He was in America. He was, you know, he was soaking up that culture, and he wrote New York City, which was like, all of a sudden it was like, oh my God, he can still do it.
It was a cool record because it was allegorical and stuff like that, you know. It was more whimsical, you know, and it was more phantasmagorical. It was Marc using words to write pictures for your mind, you know, for your ears.
It was very, very simple, and as far as I'm aware, Marc had seen a lady coming out of New York City with a puppet frog or a frog in her hand, and he must have thought that was, you know, a little bit bizarre, and promoted him to write a song about it. But the lyric isn't quite so deep. It's just a fun track. It probably means more to Marc than it does anyone else.
Well, in many ways, he did capture the lunacy of New York in that song.
It did show that the real man was still in there. The capability of writing those hits was still there.
New York City is a change again. I think he's sort of trying to reassess his look, and he's trying to reassess the way the way his music goes, and I think he's beginning to, you know, move, and he's realised that things need to change, and I think it's very important that he does, and I think things were going to change then.
Was he really just wasting his energy focusing on this American market? And in the end, he came to that conclusion that yes, he was. At that time, he had actually been spending quite a lot of time living in America. He was living as a tax exile out there, and he was heavily drinking, he was indulging in cocaine. And it got to the point where the doctors said to him, you've got to stop this binge drinking. If you don't, you're going to die. And I think that was that, coupled with the fact that after splitting up with June Child, his first wife, he had had this relationship with backing vocalist Gloria Jones, and suddenly found out that she was pregnant. And that was the thing, totally turned it on its head. He quit the binge drinking, he quit the drugs, he slimmed down massively, and he was ready to reinvent himself. To get acquainted with my
Futuristic Dragon is it's sort of it's a strange fair because it looks like an early Tyrannosaurus Rex album. Its whole presence is of it harking back to something, so maybe in a way he was harking back to a time before, and yet on the album the delivery was completely of the now and not of the then, and so it's a bit of an odd album.
That was getting cooler again though, you see. The old Periscope was coming up again now. Bit of sight.
Still a T-Rex album, but I think they still hadn't sort of... things hadn't moved on enough.
Doesn't do anything remarkable. It lends itself to look like it's one thing and ends up being something else. Bit of a lost event, really.
I saw him on the 1976 Futuristic Dragon tour, and of course by that time he'd been through his low periods as well as his high periods. And I think the one thing which by then he really did appreciate was the die-hard fans who'd sort of stuck with him through thick and thin, and he thanked us all for coming. You know, and for sticking with him. And I've got my own recording of the 1976 concert, which was at Birmingham Town Hall. And in it, he thanks us for going and seeing him and not the Bay City Rollers.
London Boys, for me, not a great record, okay, but not fantastic. Maybe just like a great, I don't know, football or tennis player, he'd peaked, and to get back, it was quite hard to get back.
London Boys was all right, no, it was all right, it was all right.
London Boys, again, I think underlines, you know, that lostness, that harking back. Because London Boys harks back to a time. He's singing about Petticoat Lane and going to Brighton and coming back. You know, it's about him, you know, the East End boy and the whole, you know, London thing. Again, it's a bit sort of soulful. He's looking back to a different time.
Don't you remember that we're just a London
In the recording studio, Marc was very keen to just whack it down, let's do it, boom, 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 you know, not too much messing around. I wholeheartedly endorse that. There's too much, you know, pissing around trying to get the drum sound, you know, no one's going to know anyway. Either hit the thing right or go home, right? And Marc played me the demo of I Love to Boogie, you know. He said, it's going to be really good when it's finished. I said, it is finished. It was perfect. I Love to Boogie on a Saturday night.
Quite a sad, pathetic little song compared to all the rest.
I Love to Boogie, great record, back on form. Surprised it didn't go straight to number one. It was really, to me, probably the last classic T-Rex record.
What a great song. Very T-Rex, very, very T-Rex. I mean, you know, you could sit that next to Jeepster and Mel Guru and all of that, and it works perfectly well.
It seemed a bit flat and a bit slightly monotonous. It wasn't as inventive as the early stuff. It wasn't as exciting as the early stuff. The stuff was starting to sound a little bit samey, or Marc Bolan's material by that stage. I don't know, it was like, it was glam, but it was the dregs of glam. And it was songs like I Love to Boogie that I think pretty much caused that whole punk explosion of a load of anarchists saying, we don't want to listen to this.
Marc's music with T-Rex was a nice bridge in a way between that innocent British rock and roll of the 50s, that sort of Cliff Richard, Billy Fury era that he rather liked and was quite charmed by, and then the more aggressive kind of rock of the 70s, and blending that together, I suppose that must have influenced a lot of people in punk rock, which came back in the late 70s, that sort of demand for innocence. But of course they were much more aggressive and powerful than the Marc's T-Rex ever were.
During the punk boom, T-Rex were like gods. The same way as Oasis looked up to the Beatles, most punks looked up to T-Rex as one of the bands that showed the way. They had a punk attitude, but with great songs. And every punk band I ever worked with always said, T-Rex quality.
It was a funny sort of time because in the music industry around 76, 77, you had this new explosion of youth culture. Back in the early 70s, when Marc Bolan had started with T-Rex, Tyrannosaurus Rex, he was kind of the height of youth culture. He was the cool thing. Now he'd gone a bit out of favor. And punk had come in. Punk was this cool thing. And Marc Bolan being this charismatic, if you like, maybe slightly a little bit arrogant kind of musician, came up with this thing. Oh yes, well, I invented punk. I was the cosmic punk.
A lot of bands have claimed T-Rex as an influence. I can see why, because it was raunchy, simple. And he was the godfather of punk, as Marc told everybody himself many times.
Bad boy. Oh, no.
The soul of my suit is again soul searching. It's very from the heart. It's very open. You know, he was exposing himself. It was a low point in his life when he was singing about it. You know, and I think those points, the dragon, you know, London boy, soul of my suit. It's quite sad. I think it's quite sad because you feel he was sort of lost.
Sold My Suit, to be quite honest, I find it hard to remember it. I've listened to it. By then, T-Rex had stopped becoming the force they were. They had records out. They were always treated with respect. They always got good television and things like that, but they didn't make the impact they were a couple of years ago.
I Damaged the Soul of My Suit. That was a cool little record.
I mean, I think Soul is a really beautiful song as well, you know, and I just wish he'd realised that. If he'd realised more that he didn't need to try so hard, he was capable of it. You pulled out my love by the roots, but I'm not such a bad boy.
Oh no. Marc Bolan was ready to reinvent himself, and his final album with T-Rex, although he didn't know it at the time, was Dandy in the Underworld, and it was a very personal album. In the past, he'd been singing all about, you know, the witches and the goblins and all these wonderful things that he'd read about in Lord of the Rings, and then he'd sort of twist it slightly and he'd be talking more about sort of light-hearted things. But Dandy in the Underworld was really him coming clean and saying, Dandy in the Underworld is me. I had these problems and I'm coming through them.
It's got all the dark side to all the success and all the money and all the fame, but it's also got that dark undercurrent, the drink and the drugs, you know, and he was a dandy, you know, he was the flower shirt wearing elf, you know, this ethereal figure. And I think that was his statement he was making on there. It was an exploration into his low points.
A lot of the critics believe that that was actually his best album. It was up there on a par with Electric Warrior. And it really signalled a time of big change for Marc Bolan. He was running out of money. He had to do something pretty quick. And I think it's funny because when musicians and bands are in that time where they've run out of money and they really, really need to do something to come up with a big hit so they can redeem themselves, they do seem to. Dandy in the underworld, can we come up for it?
Not all the tracks I love. Some of them were very, very good, and the memory of it will stay around for a very, very long time. Whether it's one of my favourite albums, and I can't really say.
You have to accept it for what it is and respect its memory of Marc. But you go back to Electric Warrior, and there's the real Marc Bolan.
It was an album that was bringing him back. Bringing him back, you know, he'd sat and really constructed and really thought about it, and maybe he was trying to recreate himself and finding it, I think, on the album, finding it somewhat. You know, there was a commercial value again there.
I remember the Dandy in the Underworld tour at Birmingham Odeon, and he had the Damned as a support, but he played a lot of his sort of the hits that he knew that people wanted to hear, but they had evolved a lot since they'd actually come out as singles, and this was now 77, and Marc had obviously spent a lot of time practicing his guitar playing and expanding, you know, his range. Girl, I'm
just a cheapster for your love. You slide so good, you're going so fast. And it was around that time that he sort of started to come up with this second career. He had done some work, he'd been interviewed on a program for Granada Television called, it was with Telly Savalas, And he had literally sort of turned this interview on its head and started interviewing Telly Savalas. It was a sort of almost like a defense mechanism, perhaps. And they saw it and they thought, you know, he's got something here. And eventually, Marc Bolan was given his own TV show, and it was called Marc. The whole idea was that he was going to get up, he was going to play his music, and then he'd bring on music guests and he'd interview them and they'd play their music. And there were bands like the Boomtown Rats and Generation X had come on, and suddenly Marc Bolan was cool again.
The biggest and the best so far this week are an amazing group called Jam!
He was really starting to reinvent himself. Everything was starting to look really good. He'd lined up Susie and the Banshees to come on. He was even lining himself up to produce Susie and the Banshees' debut album, which was 1978's The Screen. These were all great things that he had all sorted out. And the Marc was meant to be the six-part series. The final part, he had David Bowie on as a guest. They performed a duet.
The last time I actually met Marc was when I went to Granada TV studios. I went to the studio and saw David and Marc doing their big number together. And the whole thing sort of descended into farce, really, because it took so long to get the number sorted out that Marc and David wanted to do together. Being in the days of strong union representation, they pulled the plugs on Marc and David while they were trying to record the song, and the studio was plunged into darkness. So I remember the producer having fits, and Marc was in tears, and David Bowie was saying, "This is really Polaroid," he was saying. His pet phrase at the time, I think. But it was a historic afternoon. It was great to see. And of course, they did actually have the tune. They managed to get the number they were doing together on tape. And it was in the show. But that was the last time I saw Marc, was falling off a stage at Granada TV. He stumbled and tripped and fell off the stage.
The night of Marc Bolan's death, he'd actually been with David Bowie. He'd gone to Tony Visconti's studio. Tony wasn't there. You know, they talked about, oh, this would be great. Let's do a song together in this studio. And they'd gone out for a meal. And then Marc had gone on to this club with Gloria Jones. Of course, it was when they were coming back very early in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, that Gloria Jones lost control of the car. And Marc, being in the passenger seat, immediately died.
I got a phone call asking me had I been listening to the radio, which I thought was a very odd thing to ask me early in the morning. No, I haven't been listening to the radio. Marc's dead. It was shocking. It was shocking.
It was just beyond belief for me, and I was just in total shock, I think, at the time.
Elvis had died not that long before you, and I was round at Marc's house and he said, "I'm glad I didn't die today." Because Elvis would have had all the space, I wouldn't have been the lead story, you know. So he waited.
I remember I was driving my car to work at Maymont Street in London, where Melody Maker office was, and I saw a billboard, a newspaper headline saying, "Marc Bolan dies in car crash." And I was really, really, really shocked, actually, and very upset. And it seemed so brutal and sudden. And I mean, he didn't deserve that. It was an awful fate, really. And it really upset an awful lot of people because, you know, a lot of people loved Marc. He was such a fun person, and he'd been through so much and achieved so much as well. And he was just on the verge of a comeback. He'd just done his new TV series, and it looked like life was going to be good for him again.
It was almost like a cruel joke that he'd really pulled himself out from being this sort of washed up, uncool person to suddenly being cool again and having all these great things lined up. And it was so cruel that it was then that he should go and we never got to see these great things that he was working on.
If it happens at the right time, death is its own pedestal. And death has cemented Marc's place in the pantheon of rock and roll